Hello everyone and welcome to a new Tony For You video. This is going to be a different format than what I've been doing up until now on the channel. It's just a little bit of a rambling video about a topic I'm interested in with just a few notes to guide me along the way. That being said, grab yourself a cup of coffee, get cozy, watch this video in the background, or use it to get to sleep. This episode will be about Shin Megami Tensei 3 Nocturne. SMT3 is mainly remembered for its amazing gameplay, and rightly so. It's one of the best games in the series, and one of the best JRPGs of all time. But not a lot of people remember how compelling this game can be storytelling-wise, and especially the endings. Now, a lot of people, if you're playing the Maniacs Edition, are going to be bottlenecked into getting the true demon ending. For a brief recap of SMT3's story, the world ends, and the only humans left on Earth must ascend the Tower of Kagutsuchi and impose their will on the next world being created. Those wills being the reason endings of the game. Now, the endings themselves leave a little bit to be desired, but I do still feel like they're compelling narratively and storytelling-wise. The way these worlds get shaped, it might not show you what it is, but the fact is, they are shaped like that. This is not a decision that you should make lightly, and everybody playing will have a different interpretation of how they would like to see the world shaped. That's the beauty of the endings. Now, unfortunately, most people will be bottlenecked into getting the true demon ending of this game, as it's the ending with the most content, but that's what this video is supposed to be about, just trying to shine a spotlight on the endings of the game not many people get to see. The first reason you get to see in the game is Shijima by the human Hikawa, the person who brought upon the conception in the first place. The god representing this reason is Ahriman, the Persian god. He's also interpreted to be a very similar god to Angra Mainyu if you're familiar with Zoroastrianism, and he's also the ultimate antithesis, or very similar to the devil. Hikawa's ending is all about the world being a well-oiled machine, and you're nothing but a cog in it. Everybody works in a brainwashed-like state for the betterment of the society that he brings forth. The god in the SMT games is a tyrant, and I think that's a good way of putting things. This world would be not ideal, to say the least. It's almost a Kafka-esque depiction of a 9-to-5 job, but this would be the entirety of the world. Many people would think that Hikawa only wants this ending so he can be the grand dictator-like figure in this new world. If you have gotten this ending, though, you'll know that after Hikawa passes away, he recognizes that he was nothing but the Baptist of this world and you are the true creator. He then takes a back seat and passes the torch along to you as he sees his dream come true. Hikawa is very cold in his actions and doesn't hesitate to use everyone in his path, but he really did believe in this world he wanted to create. He really does want a world of silence and stillness where everybody has their goal, everybody has their task, and life is perfect, in a way. While I may not agree with the world, I can definitely see how it would be enticing to somebody. No more worries, no more stress. But no more self as well. Next is the reason of Musubi by the human Isamu. His god is Noah, or the Nameless God, a god so grand and infinite that his true name was lost in the stream of time. Musubi is all about solitude and isolation. The self is the only thing that matters in this world, and you're truly independent, completely separated from every other living being. Now, to go on a tangent, this reminds me of Stoicism. In Stoicism, to simplify it to an insane degree, it's basically the belief system that you need to come to terms with the fact that the only thing you can change in your life is your perception of it. Now, what if your perception of it was the world? In a sense, Isamu is one of the ultimate Stoics, up there with Marcus Aurelius and Seneca. I myself think Musubi is one of the better reasons, and I hope that if the conception happened in real life, this is the ending we would choose. I know if I was the Demi-Fiend, I'd choose this one. The thought of every person in the world having their own little pocket of reality that they can reside in is very enticing. Sure, being lonely would have its drawbacks at first, but I think you'd get pretty used to being in your own world and creating whatever you wanted. This is reality, after all. Now, the only thing I'm thinking of is maybe this is like a The Matrix type of situation where humans can't live in a perfect life. If our brains really were to think of a society that we would live in, would it be all that great? I'm not exactly sure, but that's why I think Musubi is very compelling. Next is the reason of Yosuga by the human Chiaki, the resident chaos ending. This god is Baal Avatar. Interestingly enough, Baal was a Canaanite god worshipped in the Middle East, then was dubbed a false god, and many demons like Baal and Beelzebub were derived from him. There goes SMT again, making us recontextualize what evil is. While this does seem to be a pretty run-of-the-mill chaos type ending, interestingly enough, a large number of angels follow this reason. Kind of puts into perspective the strict hierarchy of angels in the Judeo-Christian religions. While the angels follow this reason because of their hierarchy and nature, Chiaki made this reason because of paranoia. Chiaki as a human really only ever acted out of self-interest, and as a demon she's no different, always fearing losing her power and becoming overthrown. This reason is hard to contextualize in real life. If it were to ever be implemented in the real world, what would really happen? What would be viewed as weak? What is strong? What is weak? But I'm pretty sure that type of philosophy wouldn't be welcome in that world. Just feats of strength and tests of ability. I'm fairly certain Chiaki created this reason as a way to cope with her paranoia. Everybody wants to feel safe, but in some people's minds, the only way to feel safe is to eliminate any and all threats to their person. It's a little bit barbaric to think of the world that way, but beautiful in its simplicity, I suppose. Well, that's it for the reason endings. Let's go over the rejection endings really quick, too. First up is the freedom ending, the one Yuko Taka wanted to do before she got, disposed of. This one is pretty simple, and I can totally see anybody that wants to go for this ending first. People seem to think that this is the neutral ending, and I can kinda see where they're coming from, but even Kagetsuchi chastises the player after choosing this ending as a world with no set future and one where chaos reigns. This ending is pretty much like the ultimate snooze button, since even Lucifer says to keep your demonic powers just in case the Great Will comes after you again. You're gonna have to make a decision eventually, but you just put it off a little bit. This ending may seem cowardly at first, but it is a pretty respectable decision, all things considered. The way you choose to shape the world should not be a decision you take lightly. Maybe after you hit that reset button, the main character looks at the world more critically as he waits for the Great Will to come back. Who knows? But at the end of the day, you're back to where you started. The demon ending is next, and I think this is the one that is the most philosophically compelling. After climbing all the way to the top of the Tower of Kagetsuchi, killing everything in your path, you make it to the top and have nothing to show for it. You, as a half-demon, don't have the power to create a new world, and you destroyed any opportunity for someone else to make one as well. For anybody that got this ending their first playthrough, I hope you learned it as a lesson. Power for power's sake doesn't get you anywhere. It just leaves you in the dust. The Demi-Fiend may be physically strong, but spiritually he's weak. He couldn't make a decision, and at the end, he just went through the motions until it was all over. Just trying to think about the ultimate gut punch that the main character must be feeling as he's standing on the top of that hill, staring at the desolate wasteland of his creation. In a way, he did create a world, but just not one that anybody wants. Lucifer even comes and sarcastically congratulates the player, and then leaves. You're there, alone, with no one. You killed all your friends, and you even killed a god. A couple gods, actually. But that's it. You're here now. Better start making friends with demons. And up next is the final ending, the true demon ending, something that I'm pretty sure everybody's gotten if you've beaten this game. The one with the most content, like I said. You have to complete the Labyrinth of Amala, and the ending is nothing really to write home about. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's incredibly satisfying to see yourself become the ultimate power, throw away your human heart and take on the demon army. It's so beautifully SMT, leading the armies of Satan to go kill God. What more could you ask for in a Shin Megami Tensei game? But narratively and philosophically, it's pretty simplistic. Though I do like the idea of the way of accomplishing this ending as being proving your worth to Satan as you go through his underworld beating back his most loyal minions, ultimately becoming the general of Satan's army against God. Pretty badass. Now as a bonus, let's quickly go over the other reasons that couldn't quite come to pass. Yuko wanted to have a reason quite badly, but she didn't have the conviction to finish it off. You ended up taking the mantle in the rejection ending, but Yuko ultimately died. Though if she did have a reason, it would be uniquely different from the rejection ending. I suppose she would create a new world exactly in the image of the previous one, so I guess technically it would be like resetting the timeline. A completely new world history as well. It could have been interesting to see come to pass. Really makes you think what would happen if the world was just reset. Would the same things happen? Hunger, poverty, world wars? Or would we do the right thing and just remain monkeys? Also in the rejected reason bin is Futomimi. He was a mannequin who idealistically dreamed of a world with no inequality at all. Futomimi was a true comrade. Ideals aside, he was a mannequin, and unfortunately only humans can develop reasons. Truth is, the game was rigged from the start. Alright, that about ends my ramblings about the endings of SMT3. Leave a comment down below what you think the most compelling ending is, and which ending you'd choose in real life if you were the Demi-Fiend. I'm actually really interested to see what the majority of the people say about this topic. I have a bigger project I'm working on later, but this was just a little bit of filler, and it was something fun I wanted to do on the side. If you liked the video, leave it a like. If you really liked it, subscribe. And I'll see you in the next Tony for You. Have a good one.